Hello everyone, and welcome to No Budget Films. In this video, I will go over the 12 centuries of Byzantine history, wherein I will rank each of them, beginning with my personal best to my personal worst, by giving a summary and review of each century. Now, if you begin with the 4th century, with the founding of Constantinople in 330, and end with the 15th century, or you have the fall of Constantinople to the Ottomans in 1453, there are overall 12 centuries in the history of Byzantium, and each had its own different kind of story. Pretty much, the history of Byzantium is told per century, and again, each had its own different story to tell. And this is the whole reason to why I am making this video. Also, keep in mind that the info for this video is just based on my own opinions in Byzantine history. So if you agree, then good. But if you disagree with anything, then say so in the comments, as after all, I just wanted to do this video out of fun. Since many of you may already be familiar with what Byzantium is, then I guess there is really no need for an introduction. And so before we begin the video, please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to my channel, as it would mean a lot for you viewers to do so. Number 1. The 10th century. Basically for being such a hell of an action epic adventure, from start to end with absolutely no dull moments in between, the 10th century is my ultimate favorite of the 12 centuries of Byzantine history. Action-packed all the way with epic battles like no other, military heroes and commanders of unmatched strength, namely John Kourkouas, Nikephoros Phokas, John Timiscus, and Bardas Skleros. Scheming court politics and diplomacy, thrilling civil wars here and there, and the opulence of the Byzantine imperial court, especially in the case of the highly sophisticated scholar-emperor Constantine VII Porphyrogenitus, with his mechanically operated throne with moving lions and a golden tree with singing birds. The 10th century too shows the Byzantines in constant interaction with so many different powers around the world, including the Arabs, Bulgarians, Kievan Rus, Khazars, Magyars, Pechenegs, the new Holy Roman Empire, and more. At this time, Byzantium was not only a great military power with cutting-edge weapons like Greek fire and a well-organized professional land army, but a cultural power that the world envied, especially when having a capital so advanced and cosmopolitan like Constantinople. No wonder the Kievan Rus were inspired to take in the faith of the Byzantines. Personally, I think the 10th century would appeal most to those who want to learn Byzantine history for the first time, especially if they want to see Byzantium as the military and cultural superpower of the Middle Ages. And I suppose it would attract those into military and art history too, as the 10th century surely showed Byzantium both superior in military and art. Number 2. The 5th century. Now many of you, especially those who follow the history of Western Rome, would find the 5th century depressing. Don't worry, I do too. But no matter how depressing this time was, I would still rank it at number 2 for the 12 centuries in Byzantine history. As for all its depressing moments, it was such a crucial turning point, and usually major turning points in history are always exciting times, and the 5th century is no exception. It was such a major turning point considering the fall of Western Rome, the various new barbarian powers, and therefore the rise of the East as the only Roman Empire. Seeing all the shifting of territory in such a short amount of time in the 5th century, mainly the fall of Roman North Africa to the Vandals, as well as most of Gaul and Spain to the Visigoths, and other parts to other barbarians put together with the sudden expansion and sudden fall of the Huns, makes it something very exciting for me. Other than all the wars and territorial changes of this century, what I also find so fascinating about it are all the complex court politics, betrayals, and religious conflicts which don't seem to end. Keep in mind, the 5th century may be a confusing one, especially with there being two Roman empires, the East and West, each with their own story. But at the end of the day, both halves shared a common story, as they were always in contact with each other. Especially since the Western Empire simply answered to the East. Of course, until it fell in 476, but even afterwards, the new Kingdom of Italy that took the place of the Western Roman Empire, too, still answered to the Eastern Emperor in Constantinople. Personally, I think it was really the Western half of the Roman Empire that had more of an exciting story to tell in the 5th century, of course again until its fall in 476. While I would say that the Eastern half had a rather static early half of this century, but the second half though was much more exciting for the Eastern Romans. I think that the 5th century would appeal most to those who like learning about the fall of Rome and the rise of the barbarians, as well as to those who like complex court politics, especially since the 5th century saw two powerful barbarians as the powers behind emperors, namely Aspar, who is the emperor maker of the East, and Ricimer, who is the emperor maker of the West. For those who like studying theology, this is the perfect century to study, especially with two important church councils taking place, being Ephesus in 431 and Chalcedon in 451. And to those who like Germanic history, this is the perfect century to study, especially since the 5th century saw the formation of the different Germanic kingdoms, such as that of the Visigoths, Ostrogoths, Vandals, Franks, Burgundians, Suebi, and more. Number 3. The 6th century. Although to some, This may be their ultimate favorite century in Byzantine history, and the answer would be quite obvious. Justinian the Great, Byzantium's most influential emperor. However, for me, it is my third favorite out of 12, still pretty much high. No doubt the 6th century was a highly eventful one, as it saw the Eastern Roman or Byzantine Empire at its height of territorial extent. But if you look into the 6th century more carefully, you would come to see that all the excitement was just between the years 527 and 565, which was the reign of Justinian himself. And for this reason, I could say that the 6th century is more or less overhyped, mainly because of how everyone would remember Byzantium for Justinian only. Now don't get me wrong, I do think that the 6th century was a very exciting time, whether you're discussing the epic battles of reconquest during Justinian's time, where he actually never set foot in any battle at all, or if you're discussing the new military strategies and challenges at the time of Emperor Maurice in the latter part of the century, other than seeing the Byzantines take back North Africa from the Vandals, Italy from the Ostrogoths, and the southern part of Spain from the Visigoths. The 6th century also saw so much cultural developments taking place, including the construction of the magnificent Cathedral of Hagia Sophia in Constantinople and the mosaics of Ravenna. The 6th century now not only featured epic military conquests, great feats of art and architecture, but also some of the most interesting figures history can offer, like Emperors Anastasius I, Justin I, of course Justinian the Great, Justin II, Tiberius II, and Maurice, as well as generals like Belisarius and Narses, historians like Procopius, Jordanes, Agathias, and so many more, and empresses like Theodora and Sophia. Just like what I said about the 10th century being something like a starting point for those who want to get into Byzantine history, I can say the same as well about the 6th, especially if they want to see Byzantium as a highly sophisticated cultural empire spanning the whole Mediterranean, and this was pretty much the Byzantium of the 6th century. If you love art history, architecture, theology, or if you are basically a Roman history buff, then hell yeah, this is the century for you! Number 4, the 13th century. Okay, and now you wonder why I would put such a tragic century in Byzantine history as one of my top picks. Of course, the 13th century was such a wild time that saw so much happening for Byzantium, especially for the worse, from seeing the capital Constantinople fall to the Fourth Crusade unexpectedly in 1204, and for the next 57 years see the Byzantine Empire die, until of course Constantinople was taken back from the Latins in 1261, again by surprise. The reason now to why I put the 13th century as one of my top picks is because of how eventful it was, and how it showed the true strength of the Byzantine Empire, especially in fighting against all odds, and at the end restoring their empire from the ashes in only 57 years. This century too had a uniquely interesting story, especially in shaping the national Greek identity of the Byzantine Empire, as a result of their empire having fallen and therefore restored as the medieval Greek Kingdom of the Balkans. Something rather confusing to explain, so I'll leave it for another time. The 57 years now between 1204 and 1261 too saw so many happenings in terms of conflicts and shifting alliances between the post-1204 Byzantine remnant states of Nicaea, Epirus, Trebizond, the post-1204 Latin states known as the Francocratia, the Second Bulgarian Empire, Seljuk Turks of Asia Minor, Serbia, even the kingdoms of Western Europe, and the rising power of the century, the Mongols. With Byzantium restored after 1261, the story changes but still remains exciting, especially with the new political and diplomatic scene with the Byzantines under the brilliant yet ruthless Emperor Michael VIII Palaiologos, who ruled the restored empire at such a tough time, being threatened on all sides by the Latins wanting to take back Constantinople, as well as by the rise of the Turkish Beyliks in Asia Minor, thus forcing him to be the ruthless emperor he would be remembered as. Certainly, with the 13th century being one of my top picks, I made several videos and LEGO films set in it, and if you can please check out Summer of 1261 and its sequel, War of the Sicilian Vespers, it's just below in the description. The people I can say 13th century Byzantium can appeal to the most are those into Crusader history or Greek culture, especially seeing how the Crusaders had made their mark in Greece during the time they occupied the Byzantine Empire. However, if you don't want to be depressed, then this is not the right time in Byzantine history, as it was truly depressing that Byzantium became second rate in the 13th century, both with the Crusaders temporarily occupying it, and with Western Europe rising now making the Byzantine Empire look so small compared to what it was before. Number 5, the 11th century. Now, I've heard many saying that the 11th century is their ultimate favorite, though for me it is simply my 5th best, as true enough it featured lots of exciting moments with so much drama, political intrigues, epic battles, and interesting historical figures. But personally, I would say that the entire century itself was not all exciting, for it had a number of dull moments in between all the excitement too, unlike the 10th century before it, as mentioned earlier, which was action-packed from beginning to end. I would say too that the 11th century was more or less a reverse of its predecessor, whereas the 10th century saw Byzantium rising to its peak of cultural and military power. The 11th saw Byzantium gradually drop from an empire of power and prestige to an empire in debt, succession crisis, and great conflict, and it is for this reason why I put it at number 5. However, no doubt this century was an epic roller coaster story, beginning with Byzantium at its apogee as a medieval power under Emperor Basil II, with his full conquest of Bulgaria in 1018. But then following Basil II's death in 1025, the empire would go through a downward spiral, featuring incompetent and corrupt rulers, toxic court politics, and bad decision-making for the empire as a whole, all culminating at a catastrophic Battle of Manzikert in 1071, where the Seljuks have now invaded Asia Minor, the Byzantine heartland itself. However, the 11th century still had a satisfying ending, with Alexios I Komnenos becoming emperor in 1081, ready to restore everything before it was too late. The people that I would say that the 11th century could interest most are Viking fans, as this century featured epic tales of the Varangians, or Vikings serving the Byzantine Empire, most notably the future King of Norway, Harald Hardrada, who for a number of years served in the Varangian Guard and even became a commander. At the same time, I would also say that the 11th century story would appeal a lot to those into complex court politics, especially with the stories of scheming eunuchs like John of Paphlagonia and Nikephoritsis, as well as the story of Empress Zoe and her three husbands who were all emperors. And to those into epic battles, this is the perfect century as it featured ones like Clydeon in 1018 with a big Byzantine victory, and Manzikert in 1071 with a big Byzantine defeat. But other than that, one of the most significant events of the century was the Great Schism of 1054, as well as the beginning of the Crusade movement as a whole, which took place at the very end of the century. Number 6. The 4th century. This being what a lot would call the first century in Byzantine history, it is hard to tell whether one could start here or not. Thus, I consider the 4th century simply as the introduction if Byzantine history were a book, and the 5th to 15th centuries as the book's chapters. Surely, the 4th century featured a lot of events such as battles against the Goths, Franks, and Sassanid Empire, and interesting historical figures like Emperor Constantine I the Great, who could be called the founder of the Byzantine Empire, as he relocated the Roman imperial capital to Constantinople. Then there's Constantius II, Julian, Valentinian I, Valens, and Theodosius I. Now, don't get me wrong about the 4th century and why I put it at only 6th place. This is simply because I find the other 5 centuries I just mentioned more interesting. However, at the same time, I also find the 4th century story of the Byzantine Empire to be a bit too simple, hence I put it at 6th place. I find the 4th century much simpler basically because compared to the next 11 centuries the Byzantine Empire would face, the conflicts were not so complex, especially since for the Romans here, the enemies they interacted with were simply the Sassanid Empire in the east, and Germanic tribes to the north. Now I think that the 4th century would appeal most to those I said earlier that the 5th century would interest most, which are basically those who want to learn more about the continuation from Imperial Rome to Byzantium, as well as for those who are into the late Roman army and battles, Christian history, and architecture. As true enough, it was in the 4th century when Christianity rose to prominence, later becoming the empire's official religion under Theodosius I. While it featured so much religious conflicts as well, especially with Arianism and the defeat of the old pagan faith. For those into architecture, this is the right era to be fascinated in, especially when it came to how Constantinople was built up into a real imperial capital in only 6 years. For those into epic battles, the 4th century featured a hell lot of them, such as Milvian Bridge in 312, Chrysopolis in 324, Ctesiphon in 363, the Great Conspiracy of Britain from 367 to 368, Adrianople in 378, and Frigidus in 394. Then the epic 4th century story culminates with the death of Theodosius I in 395, where the story of the Eastern and Western Roman Empires as their own empires begin. Which is therefore why I said the 4th century is more or less the introduction century to Byzantine history. Number 7. The 12th century. Putting the 12th century at 7th place doesn't entirely mean I don't like it. Don't get me wrong. The reason to why I put it at 7th place is because I simply think it was not overall an exciting time. Sure, it had many great moments, but also a lot of dull ones too. Sure, there were many thrilling times, such as the Byzantine-Crusader interactions all throughout the century, countless battles, and the brilliant unifying of the Komnenos dynasty through marriages. And that's not even the best part. The best part was that it saw Byzantium in interaction with so many powers, including the Crusaders of Outremer, Latin kingdoms of Western Europe, Venice, Serbia, Hungary, and the Muslim powers of the Middle East and North Africa. This century actually went by so impressively, Featuring three consecutive capable emperors being Alexios I, John II, and Manuel I of the Komnenos line. But unfortunately, it did not have a great ending, as weaker and foolish men like Alexios II and Andronikos I Komnenos, and Isaac II and Alexios III Angelos came to rule the empire, eventually leading to a tragic fate in 1204, when the crusaders themselves sacked Constantinople, as mentioned earlier. The people now that I think 12th century Byzantium can appeal most to are those who are enthusiasts of medieval Europe, crusader history nerds, and those into dynastic marriages and that sort of stuff, especially with the story of how the Komnenos dynasty came to rule the empire. Overall, the 12th century is really the Byzantine Crusader century. And not to mention, my latest LEGO film, House Komnenos, a Byzantine epic, is set in this century too. So overall, it's not all that bad. Check the description below to watch it. Number 8, the 15th century. Being the last century in Byzantine history, I chose to put it at 8th place, as simply there is not really much to talk about anymore here, except for of course the last days of Byzantium and the highly climactic fall of Constantinople in 1453. It is not really the best era to study Byzantium, as one could just be depressed at how small and powerless the empire became if you read up about it. However, it also does not mean it did not have any interesting characters, as this century's three emperors being Manuel II, John VIII, and Constantine XI Palaiologos were all interesting and capable men, worthy of ruling the empire at its final days. It surely too did feature many epic battles between Byzantines and Ottomans, and Byzantium itself intertwined with Ottoman history. However, since Byzantium ended in 1453, the century is not complete, with the second half of it being another story altogether. Now I would say this century would appeal most to those into Ottoman history, as it featured the rise of the Ottomans into an empire. To those into the Renaissance, especially since it was after all the Byzantines that helped in kick-starting the Renaissance of Italy that took off in the 15th century. And to those as well that are into gunpowder warfare, as here Byzantium lived long enough to see gunpowder weapons like guns and cannons in battle. And it was after all cannons that managed to break down Constantinople's thousand-year-old walls, allowing the Ottoman Sultan Mehmed II to capture the city. Number 9, the 9th century. Now some would say this is their ultimate favorite century in Byzantine history, but for me it is not the case, again simply because not the entire century was filled with excitement. Sure, it did have a lot of great moments, battles, interactions with foreign powers, intrigues, new movements, and interesting historical figures like Emperors Nikephoros I, Michael II, Theophilos, Michael III, and lastly Basil I, the founder of the legendary Macedonian dynasty, as well as empresses like Irene of Athens and Theodora, and other figures like Photios the Great, the political patriarch, the brilliant administrator Bardas Caesar, and the rebel general Thomas the Slav. The 9th century had a rocky start, featuring the deposition of Empress Irene in 802, the catastrophic defeat of the Byzantines to the Bulgarians in 811 at the Battle of Pliska, a period of political instability and succession crisis, all while the Bulgarians were a major threat, and then the return of political stability under the Amorian dynasty beginning 820, and at the end, a new golden age beginning with Basil I, who founded the Macedonian dynasty in 867. However, I would not put the 9th century as one of my personal bests, because I find it to be rather confusing with too much happening everywhere that it could just give me a headache, while it had a lot to do about religious politics as well, which is not really my thing. Now again, those who I would think the 9th century would appeal to most are those into Slavic and Bulgarian history, as this was when the Slavs and Bulgars were converted to Christianity through Byzantium, thanks to Patriarch Photios and the missionary Saint Cyril and Methodius, while this era could fascinate those into Arab history as well, as it was here when the Byzantines had actually managed to turn the tide of war against the Arabs to the offensive for the first time, while Emperor Theophilus II kick-started the Byzantine cultural renaissance, being influenced by the sophisticated Arab court of Baghdad. And lastly, those into art history would be fascinated with the 9th century as well, as it featured a revival in the Byzantine art scene after more than 100 years of iconoclasm. Number 10, the 7th century. Now don't get me wrong again here, I really find the 7th century very epic and fascinating, especially with the reign of Emperor Heraclius and his descendants like Constance II, Constantine IV, and Justinian II, who ruled as strong and determined although despotic rulers, the great Byzantine Sassanid War from 602 to 628, the migrations of the Avars, Slavs, and Bulgars, the sudden rise and expansion of the Arabs from the south and east, and so many reforms taking place in Byzantium, including the creation of the Themes and the super weapon known as Greek fire. However, I would say that the 7th century is not really one of my favorites, simply because it was too action-packed and full of wars that it already becomes too tiring. As for me, I like reading about times that feature so much elements like politics, culture, and war, but unfortunately, the 7th century Byzantine story was mostly all endless wars and politics too complicated to understand, that it already becomes so tiring. And again, The people who I would think the 7th century would interest most are those into medieval warfare and unique weapons, especially as it was here when Greek fire first came into the picture. It could also be for those into Persian history as it saw the epic and final war between Byzantines and Sassanids. And to those into administration, this is also the best century to study, as it was here where the famous Byzantine system of administering an empire known as the thematic system, or the military provinces known as themes, first came into the picture. Other than that, this century featured some excitement, especially as it was here when the Slavs, Bulgars, Lombards, and Arabs come clashing with the Byzantines in battle. To those into the history of the Arabs as well, this is the perfect century to study, as the 7th century worldwide was really defined by the rise of Islam and the Caliphate. Number 11, the 14th century. If you want a plainly depressing story, one so long and dragging with so much unnecessary things happening, then welcome to 14th century Byzantium. The 14th century is really defined by Byzantium's decline, all fused together with so much useless things, like new religious movements too hard to understand, namely hesychasm. Sure, there were at least some bright moments 14th century Byzantium had, if you consider the reign of Emperor Andronicus III Palaiologos as one, which at least featured the last revival for the Byzantines. But other than that, honestly, everything else is just boring and depressing, especially seeing how weak and reduced Byzantium became, to the point of being just a local Greek power at the same level of influence as its neighbors, the Second Bulgarian Empire and Serbia. On one hand, complex court politics makes Byzantine history interesting, but in the 14th century, that is not the case, as here all the complex court politics that make Byzantium what it is becomes too much, too toxic, and too depressing. And not to mention, almost every event in the 14th century Byzantine story was a tragedy ever since the beginning. And as it progressed, it featured three major civil wars, one from 1321 to 1328, the other from 1341 to 1347, and another one from 1373 to 1376, in which all did more harm than good for the empire. Not to mention, 14th century Byzantium was certainly defined by greed and corruption out of hand, and more so an empire in such a pitiful state, especially under Emperor John V Palaiologos, who just possibly killed himself at the end, considering that there was no more hope for the empire. Basically, the 14th century is often the century left out in most Byzantine history books and popular media, as there is nothing really significant worth talking about, except for, let's say, the quick rise and expansion of the Ottoman Empire, which Byzantium had a part in doing, with the Ottomans assisting them in the civil war of 1341 to 1347. Now, of course, the people I think the 14th century Byzantine story would fascinate most are those into Ottoman history, as well as Serbian and Bulgarian history, as here Serbia and Bulgaria had a lot of interactions with Byzantium, and so did the rising Ottomans. To those into religious movements, this is also the century considering the hesychast movement being born here. And those into Byzantine art and art history too will like this era, as no matter how depressing the 14th century was, it also saw another renaissance in the Byzantine art scene under the Palaiologos emperors, who put a lot of attention into it. Number 12, the 8th century. And last on my list, the 8th century. It is no doubt my least favorite period in Byzantine history, and if given any chance to skip it, I will. Surely, the 8th century had its exciting moments, which was basically just the 717 to 718 Arab siege of Constantinople, ending with a Byzantine victory. But everything else was simply one long story of either disaster, as it began with a 22-year anarchy from 695 to 717, and afterwards a dragging scenario of Byzantium in a dystopian-like society under a religious dictatorship that targeted icons, which was the movement of iconoclasm. However, I could be saying that the 8th century is my worst, as there are not that much sources about it, and if there are, they are plainly biased ones, such as Theophanes the Confessor, who paints the emperors of this era, namely Leo III the Isaurian, and his son Constantine V in such a bad light, as literally the personification of evil, when in fact they were actually great and intelligent rulers, if you remove the iconoclast factor. On the other hand, since I'm not really into religious history or theology, I don't find the 8th century all too interesting, as it was mostly defined by religious issues, mainly iconoclasm, which did in fact set the stage for the schism between the Catholic and Orthodox churches. However, the 8th century had quite a revolutionary ending, when a woman took the Byzantine throne, being Empress Irene of Athens, who put an end to this iconoclast movement. Now, I would say that those who would be fascinated with 8th century Byzantium are those who like dystopian stories, as again, Byzantium was in like a dystopian state under the iconoclast emperors. Those who like Arab or Bulgarian history will like the century story too, as a lot of battles here were fought either between Byzantium and the Bulgars or Byzantium and the Arabs. And those, of course, who like religious history and debates would like the 8th century story too, as this century was really defined by the debate on whether icons were sinful or not. So this is pretty much it for my list in ranking the 12 centuries of Byzantine history. Again, all this was basically a review on the 12 centuries based on my opinions in them. If you agree or disagree with how I rank the 12 centuries in Byzantine history, please let me know by commenting below. There is really no right or wrong answer when it comes to these things. And of course, please don't forget to subscribe to my channel to see more Byzantine related content. Thanks for watching.